Reacting atoms. When elements undergo a chemical change, reactants turn to products. Those reacting elements cannot turn into any other elements. Remember, those were one of the four statements of Dalton's atomic theories, and that is still held true today. We cannot destroy matter or create matter. We simply rearrange them, and that's what's happening during a chemical change. It requires that all the atoms present when you start the reaction still have to be there after the reaction. Because the number of protons determines that identity of the atom, the number of protons in an atom cannot change, and it's stressed here that it's an ordinary chemical reaction. Now, I know there's a nuclear change, but that's blowing apart and releasing all kinds of atomic stored energy. And in ordinary chemical reactions, we're simply involving transferring electrons from one atom to another. To a chemist, the most interesting part of an atom is its electrons, and more specifically, those electrons in the outermost energy level. They're the ones that do the reacting. They are either shared, lost, or gained in the process of a chemical change. When atoms undergo chemical change, it's the electrons that begin the reacting, if you will. Not the protons, not the neutrons, and specifically the valence outermost electron shell. When atoms either lose or gain these electrons during the course of a chemical change, they acquire a charge. Remember, a neutral atom, number of protons, exactly the same as electrons. That's what makes it neutral. One positive proton exactly neutralizes a negative electron. But during the course of a chemical reaction where electrons are lost or gained, atoms develop a charge. By losing or gaining electrons, atoms form ions, I-O-N-S. Charged atoms are ions. Now, if atoms gain extra electrons, they take in extra electrons, they will become negatively charged. They are known as anions. I remember that as by thinking a negative ion. Anions are negative by having extra electrons that are not being neutralized by the protons in the nucleus. Cations are positive. I know that word looks like cation, but it's pronounced cation. See the little T inside of there? That reminds me of a positive sign. When electrons are lost, loss of electrons, we create a positive ion known as a cation. Gaining electrons makes you more negative, a negative ion, anion. Losing electrons leave a net positive charge, a cation. Ions are very different than their parent neutral atom. They behave chemically different, and they are physically different. Examples here states that if metal, a sodium metal, made of neutral Na atoms, is very highly reactive, very unstable in nature. You won't walk across in the woods and trip over a stable atom of a sodium. Instead, you'll find it in a much more stable form as a sodium ion, Na plus 1. Notice the superscript of the plus sign indicates it's lost one electron. This is how we found sodium in table salt, Na plus hooked to a Cl negative, a chloride ion. Materials such as table salt are neutral simply because they're hooking together positive cations with negative anions until we create an electrically neutral charge. So compounds form between metals that gain electrons, becoming an anion. For each negative charge the ion has, one more electron than the neutral atom. Now watch this. F stands for fluorine. It's number 9 on your periodic table. It's atomic symbol F. It tells me it has 9 positive protons and 9 negative electrons, a neutral atom. F negative 1 gained an electron. Fluorine atom, neutral. and listen to the ending for these negatives. Fluoride, hear the IDE. Fluoride has gained an extra electron, which is actually a more stable configuration. It now has the same number of electrons as its next door neighbor, the noble gas neon, number 10. Every atom wants to be like a noble gas in their electron configuration. Phosphorus, P, has the symbol P. It's number 15. A neutral atom of phosphorus has 15 positive protons and 15 electric negative electrons. Listen to the ending. Phosphide, same number of protons because it's the same atom, but now it's gained 3 electrons, giving it 18, the noble gas arrangement like argon. Place your finger on the periodic table at argon. It's number 18. When phosphorus gains 3 electrons, it's now achieved the electron arrangement like a noble gas called argon. Proton remains the same, but its electron arrangement is much more stable by filling its outer octet. The outer arrangement of those electrons want to be like a noble gas. We've mentioned anions are named by changing it to an ide. Fluorine becomes fluoride when it gains a negative electron. Oxygen becomes oxide when it gains 2 electrons. Fluoride and iodide have the same number of electrons, like the noble gas neon, number 10. IDE is used to designate a negative ion. Nonmetals gain electrons to become negatively charged. The opposite side of our periodic table are the metals. Metals will lose electrons to be formed cations. Losing electrons makes you become positive. When the sodium atom, put your finger on sodium on the periodic table, it's number 11. 11 positive protons and 11 electric, I'll state that over, negative electrons. But what if I lose one, take away one electron, it's going to become a positive one charge. Taking away a negative leaves you with a net positive. Sodium ion, Na, with a plus one charge. The calcium atom has 20 protons, 20 electrons when it's neutral, but it will lose 2 electrons to become like a noble gas, number 18, which is argon. Calcium ion is a Ca with a positive 2 charge. Sodium plus 1, calcium plus 2 carry charges. They are cations. Cations have no special rules for naming them. We simply place the word ion after the element's name. Sodium atom becomes sodium ion when it loses one electron. Calcium atom becomes the calcium ion when it loses 2 electrons, achieving the noble gas arrangement it so desires. Practice this table with me. We are looking at filling in the grid. Atomic number gives the atom its identity. Protons come from the atomic number. Now this time, since the atoms are not neutral, the electrons will vary. We'll develop a charge based on the gain or loss of electrons and place a symbol. The symbol will have the symbol of the element, and placed to the right up high as a superscript will go the charge, either a negative charge or a positive charge. Pause here and try filling this grid out. In our last video, I had asked you to practice completing the table, knowing the atomic number matched to protons, which matches the electrons if it's a neutral atom, but now noticing that we have charges, and charges develop on atoms when they lose or gain electrons. If the atomic number 16 tells us the identity of the element, that told us it was sulfur. So number 16 gave us the symbol S for the element sulfur. Atomic number matches proton number 16. Gaining two extra electrons, 18 negatives with 16 positives, gives us a net negative 2 charge. The symbol would be S2 negative, although I tend to write S negative 2. It doesn't matter the order. Remember, the negative ions would end with IDE. S negative 2, named as an ion, is called sulfide. Sulfur atom becomes sulfide. Magnesium is number 12 on our periodic table with its symbol Mg. Number 12 identifies the element as magnesium with 12 protons. Losing 2 gives us 10 negative electrons, plus 12 positive protons leaves a net plus 2 charge. To name the positive, we would say magnesium ion, Mg plus 2. Atomic number 13 identifies the element aluminum. Al is the symbol. Its number is 13. Having lost 3 electrons to form a positive 3 ion gives us 10 electrons. To name positive ions, we simply say their names, aluminum ion. And bromide, Br negative 1. The symbol shows Br with a negative 1 charge, meaning it has gained an extra electron. Starting with 36, we'll begin talking now about the pattern on the periodic table. The periodic table was first organized by a Russian chemist, Mendeleev. Mendeleev, M-E-N-D-E-L-E-E-V, is pronounced Mendeleev. He was Russian. He began ordering the elements by atomic mass and began to see that repeating pattern of properties. He defined what is currently known as the periodic law. By the way, the first organized periodic table was by how heavy the elements were, atomic mass. It is not the arrangement of the modern table, which is by atomic number. Mendeleev proposed that when elements are arranged in order of increasing atomic mass, you begin to see certain sets of properties recur periodically. Those repeating patterns began to create what we call families on the periodic table. He began to put elements with these similar properties into same columns. Columns are called groups or families. He used the pattern to predict properties of yet discovered elements, specifically geranium. GE is its symbol. He left a hole there, knowing someday we would find that element, and he had already predicted its properties. Where atomic mass order did not fit other properties, he reordered by other properties, for example, the elements tellurium and iodine. So with our periodic pattern, you see the elements that we knew, shaded deep brown, 1900 to 1949, shaded a tan color, 1950 to 1999, before 1800, mid-1800s, late-1800s, all shaded different shades of blue, so you could see the discovery or creation of elements. Remember I mentioned uranium, the last known naturally occurring element in the periodic table, and you'll notice the others have been synthetic or man-made. Francium, the bottom of the first column, is so rare it does not exist except for an atom or two in the entire world. Astatine and radon, those elements to the far right bottom column, very rare elements as well. You begin to see the discovery of the periodic pattern taking a look at our elements. As we move across the periodic table, we started to see, in just numerical order, elements 1 through 20. When we started to see elements have similar properties, number 1, hydrogen, number 3, lithium, number 11, sodium, number 19, potassium. When elements began to show similar properties, they began to organize them by column and bring everything else down with it. We now know that column to be called the alkali metals, lithium, sodium, and potassium. So all elements that were in placed in the same column shared similar physical and chemical properties. The periodic patterns show nonmetal hydrogen, that's what NM abbreviates, nonmetal hydrogen found, for example, in water. The metals, lithium, beryllium, sodium, magnesium, aluminum, potassium, calcium, all labeled as metals. And to the far right of our periodic table, we find our nonmetals. And those elements that lie between the two are called metalloids. MN for nonmetal, M for metal, or the tweener state that lie on the border, darkened here on this particular slide, known as the metalloids. Those are properties of elements that have properties that are shared by both metals and nonmetals. Here is a slide that does a nice job shading for us the major divisions on the periodic table. Notice the staircase that's kind of shaded very deep black, a staircase that separates the world from the metals to the left of that border and the nonmetals to the right of that border. And shaded in purple are what we call metalloids, boron, symbol B, silicon, symbol SI, GE is germanium, AS arsenic, SB is antimony, TE tellurium, AT astatine. Those are the metalloids. Not quite a metal, not quite a nonmetal, but properties of both. So that border isn't necessarily a clear distinction between metals and nonmetals. There are elements that exhibit both characteristics. Silicon, for example, is a metalloid. It lies to the right of this border, and yet it is a very good conductor. It's one of the major components in silicon chips for computers for conducting. We can clearly see there are many more elements that are classified as metals. Approximately 3/4 of all the elements are metals. They have a very reflective surface when clean. They're very good conductors of electricity and heat. And better than other elements, they are malleable and ductile. Those nonmetals are the opposite. Their solids are non-reflective. They do not conduct heat or electricity very well and are said to be very brittle. Most are even gases at room temperature. And those few elements that are classified as metalloids, those tweeners, their solids have some characteristics of metals and some characteristics of nonmetals. Silicon being a prime example, you can see a picture of arsenic as well. So the periodic table is divided into those three categories, the metals to the left, the nonmetals to the right, and those tweener elements called semi-metals, more often denoted as metalloids. Here is a slide showing a couple of elements, strontium and copper. Strontium number 38 lies in the second column. It is a metal. Copper lies in the middle. It's number 29, symbol Cu. These are metals that are solids at room temperature. All metals, except for mercury, that is a liquid. Mercury in thermometers, for example, is that silvery, shiny liquid climbing up and down in a thermometer. Nowadays, we use alcohol thermometers. They have reflective surfaces, very good conductors of heat, very good conductors of electricity, said to be malleable, which can be shaped. They're hammered into sheets like aluminum foil or drawn into wires like a copper wire is a great conductor of electricity. All the elements that lie left of the border are considered metals except hydrogen. Now, hydrogen is to the left of the border because it has one valence electron, but that is also a nonmetal. We'll make note of that in a moment. So, we know that metals lose electrons to form cations in chemical reactions. Metals form positive ions. And we'll see that repeating pattern on our periodic table. The opposite of metals are nonmetals. Pictured here is sulfur, yellow lump, bromine, which is a brownish, well, it's a liquid at room temperature, but you can see it turns to a gas right readily, and chlorine is mustard gas, kind of that yellowish, orangish colored gas. So clearly found in all three states, solid, liquid, and gas. Metals are mostly, or you know, all but mercury, they're solid. Nonmetals can be in any form. Poor conductors of heat, poor conductors of electricity. If it is a solid, it's very brittle. Most often, sulfur isn't even lumpy. It's going to be found in powder form. It just doesn't retain its shape. Remember the word described in the original video clip? It was amorphous. All nonmetals lie to the right of the border, except hydrogen. He's placed to the far left, usually detached on the periodic table, to remind us that although he has one valence electron, just like every other element on the column number one, he is indeed a nonmetal. He is not part of the alkali metal family. Those tweeners that lie in the center of the table, right on the border, are known as metalloids. They show some properties of metals, some properties of nonmetals, and again, silicon being that prime example of how it, what a very good conductor, and yet it's very brittle and doesn't conduct heat. You know, that makes it a very good insert for a circuit board because it's not going to conduct heat and overheat on a capacitor. So metalloids or semiconductors such as silicon touch the border. Now we mentioned Mendeleev, the Russian chemist who first started to organize the periodic table according to mass number. We ran into some areas of the periodic table where the mass numbers, just once in a while, were not as convenient to these families as their atomic number in lining them up. We began to notice that the modern periodic table, arranged in rows and columns, used atomic number. And Henry Moseley was the person associated with doing this, just reorganizing according to atomic number. Ever increasing number of proton, just as you would read a book from left to right, we read the periodic table in the same fashion. Now we know elements with similar chemical and physical properties lie in the same column. Those columns are called groups or families. Periods are the rows that go across. There are seven periods on the periodic table. Each period shows the pattern of repeated trends. So the modern periodic table is divided into two areas. We have a tall area. The tall main group are called group A's. The shorties in the middle are called the group B's, known as the transitions. The A's, tall columns, represent their number of valence electrons. They are known as the representative elements because their group number tells us the number of electrons in the outermost shell. Those are what interest a chemist. Not so much the nucleus, not even those core electrons, but the electrons in the outermost energy level. In the middle, we see what are called transition elements. They are given group Bs. Group Bs are called transitions. They transition their number of electrons in the outermost energy level. You cannot look and know based on where those elements live, how many valence electrons they have. The word valence, it means outermost. The bottom two rows are detached. They are detached to simplify the periodic table. They really do belong in period six and in period seven. With this slide, we see the tall columns on the outer edge. Whoop, let me back up. The tall columns on the outer edge are called representative elements. They represent their number of valence electrons. The shorties in the middle, I'm trying to back up. There we are. The short in the middle, shaded blue, are called the group Bs. Very important that we number our periodic table to match this particular slide. Main group elements are representative. Hydrogen's column, group 1A. Beryllium's column, group 2A. The next tall column is boron, number five there, boron, group 3A. Carbon, group 4A. Nitrogen, group 5A. Oxygen's family is group 6A. Fluorine's family is group 7A, and the noble gases, helium's family, are called group 8A, although I've also heard them called group 0. Shaded in blue are the group Bs. Notice it starts with scandium in group 3B. Titanium is group 4B. Vanadium, group 5B. Chromium is group 6B. Manganese, group 7B. Column 8, 9, and 10 are bracketed together to be one family. Group 8B contains three columns. Iron, cobalt, and nickel begins those columns. They are all classified as group 8B. Now with copper, we find group 1B and zinc, group 2B. Short guys in the middle are called transitions. The tall on the outside are known as representatives. The first family are called alkali metals. They are shaded in gold. The alkali metals do not include hydrogen. They show the elements lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, and that very rare francium. Group 1A. Next door we see the alkali earth metals. This is column 2A. Those are beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium, and radium. The alkali earth metals are in group 2A. Those transition metals are shaded in blue. They start with column 3B, scandium, and go to column 2B, zinc. The dark border separates the world from the left of the metals. We hop the border to the right where the nonmetals. The farthest right-hand column are called the noble gases. Sometimes I hear them called inert gases. They are helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, radon, the noble gases, or inert gases. The halogens, shaded in pink. Halogens, shaded in pink, are fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, or iodine, and astatine. Iodine follows the pattern of those families' names. Fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, astatine. Most commonly Americans say iodine. The halogens, halides, H-A-L-I-D-E-S, are how we would name those negative ions. Notice negatives come from the nonmetals, fluoride, chloride, bromide, iodide. All those negative ions that carry a negative one charge. The two detached rows down below, they are given names based on the elements that start their family. Element number 57 has a symbol LA. It is known as the lanthanide series. Element AC is number 89. The bottom row is known as the actinide series. Those two groups down there are named after the elements that start their rows. Remember, they belong to period 6 and 7. They have no group number. Hydrogen is an exception to this rule about where families belong. He's a detached element, typically sitting above the first column. Some periodic tables actually attach him. He is not a metal, even though he's to the left of the border. He's clearly behaving as a non-metal. He's a colorless diatomic gas. I never find just H in nature. It's always hooked together as H2, a molecule of hydrogen. Very low melting point and density, very highly reactive to forming molecular compounds. They do react with metals to form hydride, H-1. Hear the IDE? Let me say that clearer. Hydrogen ion, H+1. Hydride, IDE, hydride, H-1. Hydrogen can be a +1 or a -1. When it forms a compound. H also is the first name for acids. Hydrogen always begins acids. The alkali metals, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, and cesium, are very, very highly reactive elements with their one valence electron. Lithium, sodium pictured underneath that potassium, rubidium, cesium, very, very soft. You can actually just cut these metals with your fingernail for that matter. Very low melting points, low density. Flame testing shows they burn a specific color. Drop them into water and they will spontaneously combust, producing hydrogen gas. The alkali metals are highly reactive. They share that in common due to their one valence electron. The alkali earth metals we mentioned is beryllium's family. These are called the group 2A metals. Although slightly harder, they can still be cut with a knife. They undergo flame testing to give specific colors. They are reactive, but not quite as reactive as that first column. They're a little more stable, having to lose two electrons. And knowing that their reactivity with water to form hydrogen gas will occur as well. So the alkali earth metals is a second important family. The halogens is group 7A, fluorine's family. Fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, astatine. Iodine is a solid that sublimes at room temperature. Notice the purple colored gas. Chlorine, we've mentioned, is commonly called mustard gas. These halogens are residing in group 7A. They are all nonmetals and they all exist as diatomic molecules. It's a much more stable arrangement. I'll never find just an F. I'll find an F2, a diatomic molecule. Chlorine, bromine, iodine all exist as diatomic, very, very highly reactive. When metals form ionic compounds, the halogens will carry a negative one charge. So just listing some characteristics of the halogens, the group 7A family. Now, the envy of all of the elements on the periodic table are the noble gases. Those noble gases are the envy of all of the others simply because they have a very stable electron arrangement. Those electrons have a full outer shell. They're very inactive. They're practically inert. All are gases at room temperature. All have very low melting and boiling points. I can, in the lab, get them to react, but not in nature. And they're very, very difficult to convince to give up an electron. Remember, they have a filled outer shell. That's what everyone would like to achieve. The periodic table has a pattern to the way that ions develop. Ions are charged atoms. We've made note that metals will lose electrons to become positive. Nonmetals will gain electrons to become negative. But that charge can simply be determined from an element's position on the periodic table. By simply knowing where it lives, we see a trend to the periodic table. If metals always form positively charged particles called cations, the charge comes from the group number. The nonmetals form negatively charged anions, and for nonmetals, the charge equals the number minus 8. That's their noble gas configuration. I highly recommend spending a moment with this particular slide and literally write down onto your hard-copied periodic table the charges that you see inside of these boxes so that when you're asked to start writing compounds or formulas and then naming them, you won't have to rely on your memory to remember what charge it is. You can simply find it on your periodic table and look it up. Notice all the column plus ones. Column 2 has plus 2s. Aluminum is a plus 3. It is a metal, not a metalloid. Hydride, fluoride, chloride, bromide, iodide, all minus 1s. oxide, sulfide, selenide, telluride, minus 2, and nitride, a minus 3. The most predictable charges based on where they live. So what's the charge on the following ions? It's just a matter of taking some time and getting familiar with the location on the periodic table. Potassium cation, column 1, K plus 1. Sulfide anion, group 6A lives right under oxygen, S negative 2, sulfide. Calcium cation, column 2A, calcium symbol Ca, plus 2, calcium ion. Bromide, bromide comes from the element bromine. Bromide carries Br, negative 1, right there in fluorine's family, column 7A. Aluminum cation, Al, plus 3, aluminum ion. The negatives end in "-ide", the positives just simply say their name. Cations with a T looks like a positive. A negative ion tells me anion. On our periodic table, we might look at an element such as chlorine, atomic number 17. The name chlorine has the symbol Cl. What we notice on the periodic table is an average of all of the isotopes. The average weight of all the isotopes found in a sample is what's placed on the periodic table. It's averaging weight of 35.45. A specific isotope, a single atom, has a whole number as its weight. It's called the mass number. Please make an important note of the difference in terms between atomic mass, the weighted average of all isotopes. That's what's found on the periodic table. It will always have a decimal point. Compared to the term mass number, that is the sum of protons and neutrons for a specific isotope. The average mass is called the atomic mass. It is found by taking the fractional abundance of that particular isotope multiplied by its mass. The fractional abundance of isotope times the mass of that isotope. To determine the specific mass of an isotope, we use an instrument called a mass spectrometer. The mass spectrometry is the field that studies the weights of different elements, amongst other uses, of course. But one of the ideas of using a mass spec is to determine how many different isotopes are measured in a particular sample and how much they weigh. And it literally is just like peaks and valleys on a graph sheet determining how many different isotopes are present. So there is this, it's not even really important how a mass spectrometer works, just to understand that there is a way of detecting how many different isotopes there are, determine their relative abundance, and to determine how we go about classifying them. A mass spectrum is shown here for chlorine 35. The instrument, and again, I'm just stressing it's not important how it works, but this might be a graph readout. We see the relative abundance about 75% for chlorine 35. Looks like that bar graph slightly above. And chlorine 37 would be the second isotope. Now what we're getting here is the weight of the two different isotopes, that there are only two different isotopes, and the relative abundance based on its mass spectrum. And the instrument is called a mass spectrometer. I used one in a grad level class, so it's not something that our lab would have. But it does just spin those electrons in a high electromagnetic field and detects what comes out at the end. More importantly, we're going to be asked to calculate the average mass of isotopes. The relative abundance times the weight of the individual isotope, and that sigma represents sum in that last equation. If we have copper, and there's multiple isotopes of copper, 69.17% of all copper has a mass number of 63. From the mass spectrometer, it's been determined its specific weight, 62.9396 atomic mass units. The rest of the copper is 65, with a mass of 64.9278 atomic mass units. Remember that protons and neutrons are almost the same weight, and thus that's why it's not a whole number. We want to find atomic mass. Remember, what we're asked to do is find the weighted average. Let's suppose we have 100 atoms in our sample. And 100, that's what percentage means, is parts out of 100 parts. So if we had 100 atoms, 69.17 of them would be coming from the copper 63, and the remainder would be coming from the other copper 65. We'd like to know their weighted average. The isotope percent abundance times its mass plus, that's what this little sigma here, that squiggly E, is a sum. It's a sigma in the delta, in the Greek language. The sum of the fractional abundance. So isotope number one, we're going to take the fractional abundance. Remember to move the decimal over to get the percent sign away. So 0.6917 times 62.9396. Its percent, expressed as a decimal, times its weight. Plus the information of the second isotope, its percent abundance, expressed as a decimal, 0.3083, times its weight of 64.9278. I multiply isotope 1, multiply for isotope 2, and add them together to get this sum of 63.55 atomic mass units. Check the periodic table, and you'll see that that's pretty close to the match. You can see, then, that these problems are as simple as taking the percent abundance expressed as a decimal, multiply by the weight, do that for every isotope, and add them together. Previous slide is this slide as well. I'll read the practice for us. Gallium, 69. With a mass of 68.9256 atomic mass units, has an abundance of 60.11%. There's also a gallium 71 with mass 70.9247 atomic mass units. Its relative abundance is 39.89%. Calculate the atomic mass of gallium. That's the weighted average. The percent expressed as a decimal multiplied by its weight. Add the isotopes together. Since there are two isotopes for our problem, we'll have two to add together. So here's what we know. 60.11% weighs 68.9256 atomic mass units. 39.89% have a weight of 70.9247 atomic mass units. Multiply each of those weights by its relative abundance and sum the two together. And when we do, we find a weighted average of 69.72 atomic mass units, with 4 sig figs to match the number of sig figs represented in the problem. Atoms are very, very small, impossible to count individual atoms. We begin counting atoms by a unit introduced by Avogadro, known as the mole. The mole is the central calculation of all of chemistry. MOLE is the central unit to all of chemistry. I believe it was derived from the world of molecules, is where it was come from, has a unit of counting called the mole. If we can find the mass of a particular number of atoms, we can use this information to convert the mass of an element sample into the number of atoms in the sample. Let's take, for example, 22 copper pennies contain approximately 1 mole of copper atoms. If we weigh a single copper penny, we can get an idea of how many atoms it contains. I'm going to say a number that's a very, very, very important number that you'll end up memorizing. The number is called Avogadro's number. Avogadro, G-A-D-R-O. It's a man's name, Amadeus Avogadro, named in honor of that Italian. Amadeus Avogadro is an Italian chemist. 1 mole is exactly 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. That's a large number. 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd anythings. If I say the word dozen, you might think of 12. If I say the word pair, you might think of 2. A baker's dozen, 13. A ream of paper has 500 sheets. A gross is a dozen's dozen. That's 144. In our everyday world, we have words that represent numbers. A dozen eggs contain 12. An Avogadro's number is a mole. If I say 1 mole, you automatically think 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. A dozen is 12. A mole, 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. That is a derived number. No one has ever counted that. It's much, 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 much too large to ever count. It's even impossible for our mind to get wrapped around how large that number is. But that's the number of atoms that when I place on the scale, give me the mass in grams that's equal to the atomic mass from the periodic table. I'm going to say that better. In our previous slide, copper. I showed you some copper pennies. Here they are again. If you look on the periodic table and find the mass of copper, it will say 63.5. A single atom, one atom of copper, weighted average of an isotope, 63.5 AMUs, atomic mass units, a single atom. Now, in your imaginary mind, place 1 mole of atoms on a scale. Not a single atom, but a whole mole of them. You're going to count 1, 2, 3, all the way till you get to 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. That's how many are in a mole. If I place 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms of copper on a scale, the scale will read exactly 63.5 grams. The weight in grams that matches the atomic weight of a single atom. That's where this number is derived from. How many atoms do I need to weigh out to match the number from a scale? Look at carbon, just to kind of verify this point. Find carbon on your periodic table. Its mass number is 12. A single atom of carbon weighs 12 atomic mass units with its 6 protons and 6 neutrons. But now imagine piling atoms together of carbon. It looks like coal, a lump of black ash is carbon. We place exactly 1 mole of carbon on a scale. When I say 1 mole, I want you to think exactly 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms. Sounds like such a huge number, because atoms are so small. When I weigh out 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms, I stack them all in the same pile and put them on a scale, what will it read? It will read exactly 12 grams. The Avogadro's number, 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd, allows us to count by weighing. We can't count as chemists. Atoms are too small. But indirectly, I can count by using the mole as my exchange unit. Let's model this with a sample problem. Let's suppose I want to know the number of atoms that make up 2.45 moles of copper. We know in every one mole there's an Avogadro's number. So how many would there be if we had 2.45 moles sitting on our scale? Given 2.45 moles of copper, I'd like to calculate the number of atoms. The mole and Avogadro's number becomes our exchange. These are equivalent, just as if I said 12 inches is 1 foot. 1 mole is 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms. We simply set up a conversion factor using Avogadro's number. We start by writing what's given. The given quantity, 2.45 moles of Cu. My conversion is want over given. I want to know the atoms given the number of moles. 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms is equivalent to saying 1 mole. On your calculator, hit this with me. Hit literally 2.45 times 6.022. And now look. Do not hit times 10 caret key 23rd or you're going to get a wrong answer. The times 10 is scientific notation and we must use our scientific calculators. And that button is an E key, E, capital letters. Mine sits on top of my comma. I have to hit second function comma on my scientific calculator. Second function comma places an E on my screen and I hit 23 equals. Your screen had better read 1.48 E24. We interpret that by saying 1.48 times 10 with 24 zeros after it. We've canceled the moles and converted into atoms of copper. That number makes sense because copper atoms are so small, you're going to need a lot of them to create a mole. How about one going in the opposite direction? A silver ring contains 1.1 times 10 to the 22nd silver atoms. How many moles is that? We are given atoms as 1.1 E22. We'd like to know how many moles that is. Write down from the atoms to the mole our exchange. We know the equivalent value is 1 mole is the same as saying 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms. Just as saying 12 inches is a foot, 3 feet is a yard, and so forth, equivalent values. 1.1 E22 divide by 6.02 E23. That is your key sequence. I'm going to repeat that. Very, very important. You get the key sequence down. 1.1 E22 divided by 6.02 E23. Your screen may say 0.018266, 0.018 written in scientific notation is 1.8 E-2, so we write that as saying 1.8 times 10 raised to the negative 2 power. Since we had less than a mole, that number makes sense. Avogadro's number is larger than the number we were given, so we need to have ended up with less than 1 mole, and indeed we have. This chemical package known as the mole is a counting unit, just as the word dozen represents 12. The mole represents the particles equal to the number of atoms in exactly 12 grams of carbon. One carbon atom weighs exactly 12 atomic mass units. A whole mole of carbon plunked up on a scale, would weigh exactly 12 grams. This number, 6.02 times 10 raised to the 23rd power, that's 23 zeros after that, is known as Avogadro's number. One mole is exactly 12 grams, is the same as saying 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms. The mole introduces us to have the ability to count atoms by weighing. It's an indirect measurement to determine the number of particles sitting on our scale, those particles being atoms of elements or molecules if they're compounds. There is a relationship between mass and moles. If I want to count by weighing, the mass of one mole of any substance is called its molar mass. The mass of one mole is equivalent to its formula weight. You'll often hear me say the term formula weight. Add up the weights off the chart of the formula if it's a single atom, or if it's groups of atoms bonded together contributing to the total weight. The molar mass of that element is measured in grams. It's numerically equal to the element's atomic mass. Carbon weighs 12. A mole of carbon weighs 12 grams. The lighter the atom, the less the mole weighs, because atoms come in different sizes. That makes sense. So the lighter the atom, the more atoms there are in a single gram. There's a very direct relationship between the molar mass and the weight of the atom. Here are some samples off of our periodic table. Hydrogen, a weight of 1. 1 mole of hydrogen weighs 1.008 gram. A single atom multiplied by Avogadro's number exchanges the world of atomic mass units into the macroscopic world of grams. I can count by weighing by using what's called the molar mass of our element. The mass of one mole of any element is called its molar mass, counting by weighing. And if it's more than one element in that formula, just add the weights together. I call it a formula weight. Let's calculate the number of moles and 0.0265 grams of pencil lead. Pencil lead is graphite, the most common form of carbon. Given the number of grams, we want to calculate the mole. The molar mass is our equivalent. Find carbon on the periodic table. You will find its weight is 12.01 grams. Taking that gram unit as the exchange between the world of moles and mass, if one mole weighs exactly 12 grams, how many moles is 0.0265 grams? We simply take the gram, divide by the formula weight. 0.0265 divide by 12.01, and you will have found on your calculator, it most likely says 0.00221. In scientific notation, that would be written as 2.21 times 10 to the negative third. One mole is Avogadro's number. That's equivalent to the atomic weight off the periodic table. Notice how we have grams canceling? We've exchanged gram into mole by simply dividing by its atomic weight, called its molar mass. The mass of one mole of any element taken directly off the periodic table. Let's find sulfur. Sulfur is number 16. How much would one mole of sulfur weigh? Find its mass number. It says 32 on the periodic table. If one mole of sulfur weighs 32 grams, how many moles do we have if we have 57.8 grams? I bet our answer will be greater than 1. Given the number of sulfur grams, 57.8, We'd like to know the number of moles that that's equivalent to. The relationship between molar mass and the world of counting, Avogadro's number. We know that 1 mole of sulfur would weigh 32 grams. There's our conversion. Start by given 57.8 grams, divide by 32.07 grams, we get the gram unit to cancel. Grams divide by molar mass, and we found 1.80 moles of sulfur. As we suspected, it's bigger than one. We had a larger number of grams than a single mole would weigh. We have one more practice together. Make that two more, I'm sorry. How many copper atoms are in a penny? If a penny weighs 3.10 grams, what do we know from the periodic table? Find copper. Find it on your periodic table. What is its mass number? When you find copper, you have now found the weight of 1 mole of copper. Remember our relationship. 1 mole is the same as saying 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms. We're counting by weighing. And when we count by weighing, the exchange is called the molar mass, the weight off the chart. Did you find 63.55 grams as the formula weight of copper? That becomes our exchange unit. Start by writing what you know, 3.10 grams of copper. I want grams to cancel. It goes on the bottom. Think want over given. I want to know the number of moles, knowing that I can get from the moles to the number of particles. Divide by the atomic mass brings me into the mole. Multiply by the number of atoms, and now look, you've canceled the mole unit and brings you to the world of individual atoms. Please hit this on your calculator to be sure you're getting the key sequence. 3.1 divide by 63.55 times 6.02 E23 equal. Your screen should read 2.94 E22. That E is scientific notation for times 10 to the. The last example, counting by weighing. Tell me how many aluminum atoms are in a can that weighs 16.2 grams. Counting by weighing. I need to go to the chart. On the periodic table, find aluminum. We need to determine its molar mass. The molar mass, how much does 1 mole of aluminum weigh? I know that 1 mole is the same as saying 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms of aluminum, called Avogadro's number. We need to go to work a two-step conversion. I'm counting by weighing, where the mole is my exchange unit. When you find aluminum on the periodic table, what did you find for its mass number? 1 mole of aluminum is 26.98 grams, approximately 27. And we know 1 mole is the same as saying an Avogadro's number of particles. In this case, they're atoms. Start with what you are given, 16.2 grams. Our first conversion has to cancel gram and bring us into the mole. I cancel grams by dividing by molar mass. I'm going to multiply by Avogadro's number to cancel the moles. Key sequence, 16.2 divide by 26.98 times 6.02 E23 equals. And your screen should say 3.62 E23, which we would then write down 3.62 times 10 to the 23rd atoms of aluminum.